My name is Eric Demaine, and this is joint work with my dad, Martin Demaine, who's also in the audience. And we're going to talk about fonts as a kind of generative art. So in general, you know, we can think of generative art as an algorithmic process. So there's some algorithm here in the middle that converts some kind of input, which I'll just call a seed, could be a seed to a random number generator in this case, and you produce some cool art, music, sculpture, drawing, whatever, as a result. This is an early example of 1996 of a 1D cellular automata making some cool semi-structured patterns. And fonts are also a generative process. You may not have thought of them this way, but the input instead of a general seed is some text that you'd like to express, and you plug that into a font, and you get a rendering of that text. Now, I wouldn't call these art by themselves, but this has the same flavor in that we plug something into this box, a very simple algorithm in this case, and we get a visual output. And so what we're going to explore in this talk is, instead of just using any old font, an artistic font that's more about producing artwork than it is about expressing the words, but it does both. So these are two examples from the methods I'm about to talk about. And the text is hidden in there, though you probably can't see it. Here I'll highlight in the top one, you can see pretty clearly more than words. In the bottom one, there's some dots in a pattern here that express those words. So this is what we're going to explore, using artistic fonts as a to make art that also has as like a hidden second layer the text that you want to express. So the background here is my dad and I are both mathematicians and artists, and we wanted to, several years ago, we started exploring making fonts that actually expressed our mathematics. Every mathematician uses a font to write papers, so, you know, to write down the English and Greek letters and so on, but we wanted the font itself to be about the mathematics. And we've made dozens of fonts in this spirit. They're all freely available online on this website. I'll post a link afterwards, and you can explore them, you know, type in text, and they're usually interactive in some way, and you can see what interesting fonts using our mathematics you can get. Recently, these fonts are featured in the New York Times, so you can also check it out there. I'm going to talk about five different fonts that seem especially ripe for generative art, and in particular this Voronoi font that I've alluded to. So Voronoi diagrams, you may know, the basic concept is you start with some dots like these two, and you grow circles around them, and where those circles intersect, that's the Voronoi diagram, that purple line. And you can see here a very early example of an approximate Voronoi diagram by Descartes from 1644. They're used a lot in geometry. They naturally occur in some biological phenomena where you have growing patterns on the surfaces of giraffes, zebras, and so on. And this is an early example of generative art. When my dad and I started getting interested almost 20 years ago, of some randomly generated Voronoi diagrams trying to make stained glass patterns, or in this case, a kind of maze. And we're not the only people to explore using Voronoi diagrams for art. I particularly like this one, which is a generative process where you take an image, you sample the image according to how dark the image is, you put more points there, and you then take the Voronoi diagram and you get an approximation of that image. So here is expressing letters of the alphabet using Voronoi diagrams. So we've carefully chosen points here by hand so that the Voronoi diagram itself traces the letter. So this is with the points and the Voronoi diagram. If I erase the points, you can more clearly see every letter of the alphabet. So that's one approach. We call this Voronoi font. A kind of inverse approach is that I put points along the strokes of the letters, and then compute the Voronoi diagram. Now if I erase the points, I get a more abstract representation of the letters. In principle, the letters are still encoded in there, but it's much less obvious to see them. So we call this the inverse Voronoi font. And the new idea in this paper, so Voronoi font we developed a few years ago, but we always intended for each of these letters to be like a standalone Voronoi diagram. And we realized for making more interesting tilings and drawings, you can combine multiple letters into one big Voronoi diagram like this. And the letters are still in there, but they're a little bit harder to see unless you color them differently. And you can do the same thing with the inverse Voronoi font. You get an even more abstract version of the letters. So here are some simple examples, just sort of playing around with this. Here we have alternating patterns of X's and O's, and you get kind of a cool regular tiling. Or here's the same thing in the inverse Voronoi font. Or you can make irregular patterns too. So this is a nice kind of centrally symmetric pattern where we have a big X here where we've written the letter X, and all of the other letters space in between are the letter A. And so you can just throw random text in here and get interesting patterns. This is just the letter O, but spaced out in a somewhat random way to get some nice interactions between the different Voronoi diagrams. Here is a kind of self-referential, so getting more interesting artwork here. So on the top we have an inverse Voronoi font, and it's hard to see the letters, but if you extract them, you get this pattern of dots at the bottom, generative art made by Voronoi diagrams, so describing itself. And then, of course, once we have tilings, we can play with coloring them. So here we're coloring them with random saturation and lightness values in a yellow hue, because the text that's hidden inside here is relates to stars. So you can stare at it for a little bit, and maybe you will see on a reveal, twinkle, twinkle, little star is the hidden message. And so you can play with the colorings here and the different hues in order to hide or express the message inside. Here's just a nice example in the red hue. This is of the words tiling, 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 with some spacing, and you just get some really cool patterns. This is one of our favorites. And now I will give a quick demo of the software. This is, again, online. It's also open source on GitHub. You can play with it. So you can type in whatever text you like. So here, for example, is just a bunch of G's and A's. This is in one pattern, and maybe I'll turn on random cell coloring. And I will maybe restrict the hues, increase the lightness a little bit, and maybe reduce the saturation. So something like that. So you get some nice patterns, and you can change where you maybe inverse pattern is also nice. You can add some spaces here to kind of fool around with how things are made up, or change the alternating pattern between G's and A's to A's and G's, or write whatever text you want in the middle, and you get some cool pattern automatically generated. So I encourage you to play around with that. Make your next bathroom tiling. And I'll just briefly talk about a few other fonts and how we can use them to make generative art as well. So this is what's called the origami maze font, one of the first fonts we designed, where it generates a crease pattern which folds into a 3D structure of the letters. So here is an example of a crease pattern on a square piece of paper that, if you fold it itself, makes a square outline and the word square in the middle. Or here's another one, again, with an encoded image. If you stare at it long enough, and if you're an origamist especially, you can decipher it. Eventually you see it is word art. If that folding was too complicated, here is a much simpler folding. It's easier to visualize. It's just a single fold you need to make. And so on the left and on the right, we have two patterns that don't look like letters. But when you fold in half with semi-transparent paper, you get the intended letters. So a very simple kind of hiding of the text, and kind of a puzzle when you look at one of these, can you fold it in your head and figure out what it's going to fold to? Here is folding to the word text. Here we're playing with geometry a little bit and folding the word heart, but also in a heart shape. And here is a self-referential example. So this one, when you fold it, says fold this in half, which is instructions for how to fold it, which of course you can't read until you've already folded it in half. So good luck. So lots of fun things you can do with this technique. Next example of a font is inspired by Glass Cane. So this is a centuries-old technique in glassblowing. My dad and I are also glassblowers. And if you've ever seen glasswork like this, with this, lots of intricate little lines, this is an example by Lino Tagliapietra, then it's made out of glass cane, something like this, where you take straight lines of glass color and pull and twist them in a helix. So we designed new glass cane around letters of the alphabet, where you take colored rods of glass in the pattern of a letter, so this is like a cross section, and then you pull and twist that and you end up with this really cool pattern. And you can make these in glass as well. We also print them onto paper. This is, I believe, the full alphabet A to Z twice, printed on a piece of paper and then folded into an origami sculpture. And the last example I'll show you is just dots, black and white dots, a little more modern. This is, I think, just a nice pattern of dots, and it is actually the input to a puzzle called a yin-yang puzzle, where you need to connect all the white dots and connect all the black dots while keeping them both thin. And in this case, the puzzle is generated algorithmically, and it has a unique solution, which is also a nice pattern of dots. And if you stare at it long enough, you can see letters in it. This is a little more subtle than some of the other fonts. So there's a C here, O, N, X, D, O, T, S. So this is connects the dots, which is sort of self-referential, again, trying to describe how to solve a yin-yang puzzle. So that was a little tour of some different artistic fonts and how you can use them to make, to generate art. Hope you enjoyed it. Thanks.